The Republican Party is a historic party that has been the host of a variety of platforms and seen many presidents over the years. Such presidents include Abraham Lincoln, Theodore Roosevelt, Dwight D. Eisenhower, Ronald Reagan, and of course, Mitt Romney. In this presentation, we will look at the collapse of former political parties, how the Republican Party was founded, the first election the Republicans entered, and how each member of the team of rivals came to join the party. The formation of the Republican Party was most directly precipitated by the Kansas-Nebraska Act. This controversial act caused various divisions and unions of political parties, most principally over the issue of slavery. The party that received the greatest divisions was the Whig Party. There was never a truly consistent Whig political philosophy, except in the negative sense of opposing excessively concentrated power in the federal government. The Whigs were opposed to the Mexican War, leading to the decline of the party's popularity in general. The issue of slavery split the party in two, the Concise Whigs and the Cotton Whigs, who, after the split, joined the Republican and Democratic parties respectively. Concise Whigs in the North favored the abolition of slavery and halting the institution's spread into new territories. The Cotton Whigs in the South took the opposite viewpoint. Like the Whigs, the Democrats were divided by the Kansas-Nebraska Act, although to a lesser extent. Whilst the majority of Democrats were located in the South and were in full support of slavery, the Northern Democrats felt as though the Missouri Compromise was the fabric that held together two separate sections of the nation, and were shocked by its repeal. These anti-Nebraska Democrats and anti-Nebraska Whigs joined together under the new banner of the Republican Party. Allen E. Bovee, a former Whig, founded the party, and on the 20th of February, 1854, in Ripon, Wisconsin, they held their first meeting on the topic of anti-slavery. In 1856, the Republicans entered their first election. While William H. Seward was considered as their nominee, John C. Fremont was chosen. While Fremont had led several expeditions in the West, he had no political record. Fremont was pitted against Millard Fillmore, a former Whig president who had served only one term. Upon the dissolution of the Whig Party, Fillmore ran as a member of the American, or Know Nothing Party. Fremont's other rival was James Buchanan, the Democratic nominee. Franklin Pierce, the incumbent president, was refused the nomination by the Democrats, who wanted a candidate who is not opinionated on the devised issue of Bleeding Kansas. In this election, the Republicans denounced the Kansas-Nebraska Act and the spread of slavery and advocated Whig ideas of internal improvement. While they won several North and Northwestern states, Buchanan won all of the Southern states, many Midwestern states, and California. Notably, he won a third of the North and Northwestern states. The Know-Nothings only succeeded in winning Maryland. Despite their failure in the first presidential election, the Republican Party grew even larger in size. They were joined by the nativist Know-Nothing Party, which had garnered even less votes in the election. The Know-Nothings were primarily an anti-immigration party. They opposed slavery because it gave immigrants a better chance at getting jobs. They were also joined by the briefly active Free Soil Party. This party consisted of white Northerners who had come to believe that the existence of slavery was dangerous not because of what it did to blacks, but because of what it threatened to do to whites. Free Soilers argued that at the heart of American democracy was the right of all citizens to own property, to control their own labor, and to have access to opportunities for advancement. The name Free Soilers came from their idea that the proper structure of society should be centered on the belief in free soil and free labor. This inspired the Republican platform in 1860, which was free soil, free land, free labor. The Free Soilers and Know-Nothings eventually joined the Republican Party as their anti-slavery views were aligned and slavery had finally entered primary focus. The new Republican Party was joined by Lincoln and the future members of his cabinet, as discussed in Team of Rivals. Each one was a Republican nominee for the presidency in 1860. It's been said that nobody contributed more to the foundation of the party than Salmon P. Chase, future Secretary of the Treasury. Chase had changed his political allegiances many times, originally entering the political sphere as a Whig, joining the briefly active Liberty Party, and becoming a prominent Free Soiler. Chase bore no powerful loyalties to his former parties, only to his primary motivation carried between them, the abolition of slavery. He was successful in becoming the first governor of a major state, Ohio, belonging to the Republican Party. He also succeeded in uniting sympathetic German immigrants and know-nothings into the party by running with a ticket including 8 prominent know-nothing candidates while not endorsing any of their anti-immigrant beliefs in his platform. Edward Bates, Lincoln's Tepee Attorney General and Madison's boy, was a member of the Whig Party until their breakup. Bates reprimanded both the Republicans and Democrats for threatening to tear the Union apart by agitating the issue of slavery. After this, he chose to join the Know-Nothing Party like Millard Fillmore. He joined the Know-Nothings not out of a fanatical nativism, but out of fear of sectionalism created by the bold anti-slavery position of the Republicans. However, he stayed with this party only briefly before joining the Republican Party. William H. Seward, another Whig who would become Secretary of State, was initially reluctant to join the party. He bore animosity to the Know-Nothings who were joining the party, having once fought with them after attempting to fund Catholic schools in New York. This measure was intended to keep the masses of immigrants out of poverty and provide them with a chance at education, which entirely contradicted Know-Nothing philosophy. Seward's advisor, Thurlow Weed, managed to secure enough votes for him to be re-elected into the Senate. With 6 years of guaranteed stability, Seward was liberated to join the Republican Party. Once he had taken up the Republican banner, Seward provided assistance in conceiving the party platforms. His prominence also ensured that he would be the party's lead spokesman and the leader of their movement in New York. Abraham Lincoln was hesitant to join the party for many of the same reasons as Seward had. In a letter to his friend Joshua Speed, he said, "As a nation, we began by declaring that all men are created equal. We now practically read it as all men are created equal, except Negroes. When the Know-Nothings get control, it will read all men are created equal, except Negroes and foreigners and Catholics." However, he too succeeded in uniting the parties without conceding to the bigoted views of the Know-Nothings by delivering a powerful speech that managed to ignite anti-slavery feelings. While the speech was never recorded, it is credited as a reason he became the leading Republican in the state of Illinois. The Republican Party united the many separate parties and factions that had existed under one clear goal, the abolition of slavery. As Bates and many others had feared, such a major party with such a radical goal caused tension unlike the Union had seen before. With only two polar opposite parties in play, both bound so tightly to separate regions, the political sphere became increasingly sectionalist, and the threat of secession grew like never before. The South perceived a political party with the strength to potentially win a presidential election and the goal of abolishing slavery as a direct threat to their way of life. Meanwhile, the North had now united as a region under an anti-slavery banner, causing many to give up their moderate positions. The formation of the Republican Party would lead to one of the most fateful elections in American history, which would be the tipping point for the start of the Civil War.